Let us start once again, ladies and gentlemen. I shall talk about the Mekhitarist Congregation of San Lazzaro as guardians and propagators of the legacies of Saints Gregory of Narek and Nersēs of Gada, known to many as Saint Nersēs the Gracious. My plan is to say something about the origins of the Mekhitarist order, the Mekhitarist Congregation as they are known, and something about their contribution to scholarship, including sacred music, which is one of my own personal main interests, and then introduce you to the two saints in question, namely Saint Gregory of Narek, of whom we heard a little bit in the preceding presentation, and Saint Nersēs the Gracious, who is very important, particularly this year, as we are celebrating, we are marking 850 years since his passing, including very major events to take place at the Vatican in December this year. And I will be referring to the contributions the Mekhitarists did in developing and preserving and propagating the legacies of those saints. The father of the order, who as a young man was called Manuk, and upon taking church orders became Mekhitar of Sebaste, the most succinct way of describing his attitude would be to say he was not a dogmatic person, he was what these days we might refer to as a Christian humanist, an enlightened Christian humanist, one might say, possessed of a very, very profound spirituality and with a passionate yearning to acquire and share with others scholarship. Driven by this yearning, he became very close to a number of Catholic clergy with whom he had contact. After all, there were good relations between Catholic clergy and Armenian Orthodox clergy at the time. And eventually he concluded that in order to fulfill what he considered to be his life's mission, he could do it best in collaboration with the Roman Catholic Church. So he became a Catholic, although until the end of his life he was under suspicion by fanatical Catholics for not being a proper Catholic, and under suspicion by Orthodox Armenians for being a fanatical Catholic. This often happens to people who build bridges, and he was a bridge par excellence, and I think he was very, very sincere in what he did, and he was astonishingly effective in what he did. There is no doubt that he was a genius and a visionary, and perhaps he ought also to be considered a saint, and the process for his beatification has been advancing recently. A year ago I had the very great pleasure of attending a ceremony on the island of San Lazzaro, attended by the Patriarch of Venice and other high-ranking clergy, because the first stage of the beatification, namely that of the Diocese of Venice, was successfully concluded. He got together a group of like-minded young religious in 1701, and that is when we could consider the congregation to have been founded. They had to leave because of persecution by the Ottoman authorities. They went to what was then known as the Morea, which was part of the Venetian realm, but when it became clear that Morea is going to fall to the Ottomans, he had to move again, and eventually he settled in Venice, and indeed 5 or 6 years ago we celebrated the establishment of the congregation on the island of San Lazzaro in Venice, where it exists to this day. However, when he passed away, his disciples had some disagreements, and a certain number of the monks, the members of the order, in fact the majority at the time, they left San Lazzaro, initially to Trieste, and then established themselves in Vienna, where they still remain. They have been there since 1810, and last 2 days I was staying in that monastery, in fact, as a guest of the congregation. But I'm very happy to say that the two parts of the congregation were reunited in the year 2000. So though there are two big monasteries, it is one single united congregation. wrote a number of short tracts on spirituality. He composed hymns and odes, works on doctrine, on the liturgy, but also we owe a number of monumental works to his pen, a huge lexicon of the Armenian language, a very beautiful edition of the Bible, a commentary on St. Matthew and various other things. But in fact, the major achievements of the congregation took place during the centuries afterwards, but they got a tremendous start thanks to his vision. I mentioned the Vienna Monastery. This is where it is, and this is the Church of the Monastery, St. Mary the Protector. I am a frequent visitor to San Lazzaro for research purposes, but also for spiritual enrichment, and can testify that it is indeed a place of calm, palpable spirituality, and a very strong love of scholarship and yearning. And since the lifetime of their founder, the congregation opened no fewer than 30 schools in Europe, in the Middle East, in the 20th century, even in the New World. And they educated the secular intellectual elite of the Armenian people, as well as producing gifted theologians and scholars. They produced many editions, translations. They established a very important periodical press. And indeed, the journal Pasmaveb, which the Mekhitarists continue to publish to this day, is deemed to be the oldest still running scholarly journal in the whole of Italy. There's another one called Hantes Amsoria, published by the Vienna Monastery. They have an enviable liturgical tradition, and that is why I like to spend Holy Week there, because the services are performed completely in an unhurried way, in a wholehearted and very devout manner, which is very, very nourishing. And you have to remember that the Armenian monastic tradition was brutally destroyed everywhere, within present-day Armenia by the Soviet rule, in the Ottoman Empire by the genocide and wholesale destruction. So in fact, San Lazzaro is very, very unusual in having had a continued, uninterrupted existence for three centuries, and that continuity gives it a certain quality. Both the San Lazzaro and the Vienna monasteries were very, very strong on philology, lexicography. They translated in several directions. They translated Armenian spiritual classics into Western languages and masterpieces of Western spirituality and theology, but also secular literature into Armenian, thus bringing the Armenians closer to European civilization and vice versa. There are major theological works, exegetically in character primarily. There's a massive commentary on the Psalms by Father Mikhail Chamachian. And in a moment I will tell you about some of the exegetical works regarding St. Gregory of Narek's Book of Lamentation, which is a very great masterpiece, and also a very substantial exegesis of the Armenian canonical hymnal. It is amusing to note also that the monks of San Lazzaro were associated by with none other than Lord Byron, the rather flamboyant English poet, who, though he was in Venice primarily due to his interests in philandering, nonetheless, he did have a spiritual streak, and it is said that either he would be rowed or he would swim to the island of San Lazzaro, where he had lessons with the monks and he learned classical Armenian. And in fact, he co-authored a textbook of classical Armenian with Father Harutyun Avkerian, Pascal Auker. And that textbook is still useful, and I recommend it to my students. So that is a little amusing thing. And this is a painting by Ivan Ivazovsky that reimagines the first visit of Lord Byron. Obviously, he hadn't arrived swimming on this occasion. He came with that gondola. and he is being received by the monks. And if you look at the attire of the monks, it is very similar to what is worn today, and you can see that they look very much like Catholic religious. And so, very briefly, the brand of Catholicism, were they genuine Catholics, or what was the sort of approach that they had, and how did they try to bridge the gap between the Armenian Orthodox Church and the Roman Catholic Church? It is very interesting to follow the description of how this was done, written by Archbishop Malakia Ormanian, who is a very interesting scholar, because he became patriarch in Constantinople for